I want to start this video by giving you some problems that you may have seen before. So try out these problems first, then we'll talk about the structure of these problems before getting to what these problems reveal about how humans reason. Here are the problems. A bat and a ball cost $1.10 in total. The bat costs a dollar more than the ball. How much does the ball cost? Problem two. If it takes 5 machines 5 minutes to make 5 widgets, how long would it take 100 machines to make 100 widgets? Problem number three. In a lake, there is a patch of lily pads. Every day, the patch doubles in size. If it takes 48 days for the patch to cover the entire lake, how long would it take for the patch to cover half the lake? Okay, so hopefully, if you haven't tried those problems before, you've given them a shot now. These questions make up what is called the cognitive reflection test, or CRT. These questions all share a similar structure. There's an appealing intuitive answer that is incorrect. But once you have rejected that intuitive answer, once you've stopped to reflect a bit, the correct answer doesn't involve a lot of calculation or thinking, really. The intuitive answer to the first problem is that the ball is 10 cents. But that doesn't work because if the bat is a dollar more, that means the bat is $1.10. And once you add 10 cents to $1.10, you get $1.20. The correct answer is that the ball is 5 cents and the bat is a dollar more, meaning the bat is $1.05. And when you combine those together, you will find that they equal $1.10, which is what the question asks. For question two, a lot of people say 100 minutes, but the answer is just 5 minutes. Since we have the same ratio in terms of machines and outputs, the time that it is going to take will be the same. In other words, from the given information, it takes 1 machine 5 minutes to make 1 widget, so it will take 100 machines 5 minutes to make 100 widgets. For question three, the intuitively wrong answer is 24 days. People get there by just having 48, but that isn't right because the coverage of the lily pads is doubling every day. And so starting from 48 days when it's completely covered, we just have to go back 1 day to 47 for when the lily pads will only cover half of the pond. For all of these questions, the intuitively wrong answer comes from matching up elements of the problem together that don't really deserve to be matched together. For the first question, you see a dollar and you see $1.10, and the question seems to be about subtracting, so you just subtract those two, even though it doesn't make any sense to do that. In the second question, I see 5 and 5 and 5. Well, 100, 100, and 100 would continue that pattern. I see half, and I know what the total number of days is, which is 48, and so I just have the number of days, even though, again, it doesn't make any sense to do that. These questions were collected and designed by Shane Frederick, who was interested in coming up with a measure of reflective thinking. How many people really stop to think before they answer a question? And the answer seems to be not that many people. In the first studies using the CRT, less than 50% of participants got all three questions right. And in some experiments, as few as 6 or 8% of the research participants got all three questions correct. So that means the vast majority of people in these experiments got at least one question wrong, and many got all three of them wrong. One of the interesting aspects of this is that the people who get the problems wrong think that the problems are easy and think that everyone is going to get them correct. A large number of the people who get the problems correct realize there's something tricky about the problem. They still overestimate how many people are going to get it correct, but they know that they had an intuitive answer that they had to reject, or at least that seems to be the case, especially from the earlier studies. Now, the structure of CRT problems makes them quite different from another class of problems, which are usually called insight problems. So let's look at one of those insight problems to see how the structure is different. Here we go. I'm going to read one. A man in a small town married 20 different women of the same town. All are still living, and he never divorced. Polygamy is unlawful, but he has broken no law. How can this be? Insight problems require what is called cognitive restructuring. In this problem, a lot of people initially interpret the word married to mean getting married to someone else, like you married your spouse. But in English, sometimes we also use the word married to mean you married two people together, like a priest might marry two people together. So to solve this riddle, we have to reinterpret what the word married means. Maybe this person is a pastor or a rabbi of some kind, and they marry other people from time to time. With a problem like this, there is not an attractive, intuitive answer that is incorrect. The feeling with a marriage problem is a little bit more like, I don't see how this could possibly be true. I don't see how there can be a solution here. The feeling with the CRT problems is more like, this is easy, I got this. Oh, wait a minute. Now to the main question. Why do so many people get these cognitive reflection test questions wrong? The first explanation is one that we've already talked about. It's the tendency to reflect or the tendency to reject an intuitive answer that is appealing, and that's the answer that your brain kind of immediately comes up with or immediately pops out when you first read the question, right? This was Frederick's whole original idea. He created these problems specifically to measure this tendency, and this idea is closely linked to the idea that, in general, more reflection helps you to solve problems more effectively. Other researchers have found a lot of support for this basic idea. Keith Stanovich and his colleagues, for instance, have found that the cognitive reflection test, right, these three questions that we have people answer, predicts rational thinking much better than, say, a full-fledged IQ test, which might take a couple of hours to administer. And there's other research in more practical contexts that looks at how this tendency to reflect can help people to evaluate information more critically and more accurately. And a lot of researchers think that this tendency to reflect that the CRT is measuring is an important component of critical thinking, just the ability to stop yourself and reflect for a bit. But there's a second explanation. Maybe it's all about numeracy. If you haven't heard this term numeracy before, numeracy is to numbers what literacy is to reading. So numeracy is a basic math ability involving things like time, ratio, proportions, measurements. All of the questions on the CRT involve numbers. So it's probably not that big of a surprise to find out that measures of numeracy, that is, like how well people can figure out proportions and stuff like that, correlate quite highly with performance on the CRT. Math performance on standardized tests is more highly correlated with the CRT than reading performance on standardized tests. So now we understand that these questions are testing two different things. They're testing the tendency to reflect, but they're also testing a baseline mathematical ability. But there's another explanation. Maybe the CRT questions actually are insight problems. A few years ago, a few researchers at the University of Missouri did something pretty clever. They gave people the standard questions from the CRT, but they presented these questions in a multiple choice format. So there were four choices, and people had to choose which one was correct. But crucially, they did not give people the attractive, intuitive answer. So they didn't give people 10 cents in the baseball problem. They didn't give people 100 in the widgets problem. They didn't give people 24 in the lily pads problem. If these questions really do measure the tendency to reflect, then the overwhelming majority of people should be getting these multiple choice versions of the questions correct. But the whole point of the CRT was that if you reject your first intuitive guess, then the correct answer is very, very easy to get. And in the multiple choice version, you don't even have to come up with the answer yourself. You just have to recognize which one it is. So what happened in their experiments? Well, more people got the questions correct. Okay, that's consistent with the idea that these questions actually do measure a tendency to reflect. However, people still got these questions wrong about 50% of the time. That is not consistent at all with the idea that these questions are straightforward measures of the tendency to reflect. In fact, what seems to be happening with some people is that they read the question and they look at the possible answer choices and they don't see the intuitive answer there. And so instead of thinking, well, I might be wrong, they think, there must be something wrong with this question. I'm afraid this psychologist who's asking us this, they must have made a mistake somewhere. The multiple choice versions of the CRT questions are similar in structure to the insight problems. With the insight problems, there's no intuitive answer available. With the multiple choice questions, there's no intuitive answer available. So it seems like, based on this research, that the CRT questions also involve cognitive restructuring, not just reflection. If we go back to our marriage problem, all of this material suggests the wrong interpretation of the word married. And we have to reinterpret that word against the kind of implications that the words are giving us. Similarly, something about the CRT implies not just the intuitively wrong answer, but a misinterpretation of the question itself. So these questions that initially seem to be elegantly measuring a single construct, a single idea, which is the tendency for someone to reflect, actually measure a bunch of different stuff. They measure the tendency to reflect, they measure someone's numerical abilities, they measure the ability or tendency to restructure or reinterpret questions, as well as probably a bunch of other stuff that we haven't explored yet. In some cases, people seem to answer these CRT questions without reflecting at all. That is, they do not report an intuitive wrong answer that they first had when they go about solving these questions. Now, if you have a high level of numeracy, the correct answers themselves may simply be intuitive to you, right? You don't jump to the wrong answer because you've seen a lot of questions like these in the past and you've honed your intuition for these kinds of questions. The downside of all of this is that we don't have this clean measure that Frederick was hoping for. But the upside is that these questions have helped us to discover more about how people solve problems. For more on the nature of problem solving, I have a much longer video over here. You can check that out. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.